Hello, everyone, and welcome back once more. It's my delight to introduce you to my next three guests, starting here with you, Steve Whiting, Head of Payments Technology at Soldo. And then we welcome Paul Konsbruck, CEO of LuxConnect. And finally, we have my first female of the TV show, which is Femke Brouns, Head of Marketing, PR and Events for Benelux at Polestar. Welcome to you all. Oh, hello, Ving. It's very nice to see you there. It's lovely to see all these people around that we haven't seen in a while. Now, Steve, I'm going to talk to you first of all when I pick up my pieces of paper. You are Head of Payments Technology at Soldo, and we're going to talk about embedded finance. I mean, for those of us who don't know, what is embedded finance?
Well, I think embedded finance can be many things to many people, but a good definition is that when you're at the point of buying something, to be offered something else, in a sense of to enhance that experience, to give you the opportunity to buy in a different way. So for a long time, buying a car involved a form of embedded finance, which would be the loan, the payment plan that goes with the car. And in many ways, going to a car dealership was about buying finance even more than buying a car. With technology, embedded finance is at the point of interaction. For example, last night I bought something on Amazon, and immediately I was offered a tailored insurance that went with that individual product at a very low cost, a very compelling sort of offer that could be instantly accessible and very easy to benefit from.
I love that form there where you're combining a loan in my thought process. I'm now thinking of mortgages. It sounds exactly nicer to think about a mortgage as embedded finance than a mortgage, a bit of a weight around our necks. You mentioned Amazon as well. Samsung, I think, also have embedded finance. So there's a number of companies doing this right now. So you seem to think, and it seems to be the case, that we're moving towards an embedded finance society. So what do you think it will mean for us in the coming years as customers?
I think that really embedded finance, like many of these things, is more of a manifestation of a recognizable component of interaction that actually represents an incredible array of technological advances over many years, because that thing on its own is just the noticeable culmination of a change in the way that people are interacting with other people. Because when you're buying or you're selling, and everybody on the planet is involved in some form of buying and selling, you're exchanging energy. You're exchanging the energy that you've put in with your own efforts and endeavors to be paid to create something, and then to exchange that for something else that somebody else had put their energy into. That's the fundamental sort of history of commerce, which underpins society. So at that very point, we think buying and selling using a payment is pretty archaic when we look at everything else in technology today. So the act of selling, the act of buying, is now about to change radically. And the sort of the poster thing for that change is one of the main things there is embedded finance, because we can see that it's a recognizable value. Something like 70% or more of the recognized main brands in Europe are now either engaged in or planning to be engaged in embedded finance projects. And the value of this industry is calculated to be in the region of $7 trillion over the next 10 years, according to whichever analyst that you read.
I must say, you're very good with your analogies, bringing us back to the philosophical thoughts of how commerce first began and this energy transition between person and product and creations. I really like that analogy. So then we must think of banking. We've already seen a huge shift in how we bank, how we save, how money is used and shifted, and what money even will be in the future. So with your work at Soldo and payments technology, it's fintech really. Tell us what you view as the shift that we will come to observe and live in the world of banking in the next decade.
Well, banking is evolving, and the rate of change for this technological evolution is increasing. So if we're on a curve that is going like this right now, technologically driven in society and in human evolution, we're at the very beginning of that curve. And every curve that does this is a series of waves that go up and down as you accelerate the change. Banking is evolving all the time in this way. Financial technology, fintech, is driving that change. Embedded finance is a manifestation of the change. And therefore, banking changes by its very nature. It doesn't go away. It shifts from one place to another. And the companies, the actors, change, but the end result is commerce, buying and selling. Banks are the store of value of the energy that people are putting in, and that store of value, whether that is fiat currencies, whether it is anything else in crypto, and using blockchain, all these things are buzzwords in a sense. There's a broad technological change that is changing the way that banks operate, the central value of banks in society. No, I don't think they'll go away. I think they'll just become more important for storing the value.
How close are we to a cashless society?
I think we're very close. I think it's inevitable. I think there will be a lot of people who resist this. There's a certain philosophical debate that needs to be had and needs to be surfaced. But inevitably, technology must have technical components, and the cashless store of value and cashless exchange of value for machine-to-machine interactions is inevitability. And the sooner that we realize that, we can address it on a sociological basis.
Steve, thank you so much. And I very much enjoyed your phraseology and your analogies there. Moving to you now, we're going to talk about LuxConnect, a glimpse of tomorrow's connected cities, in fact, with Paul Konsbruck, CEO of LuxConnect. Now, we know that there's been an exponential need for increasing amounts of complexity in computing power. And I want to talk to you about something that's happened here in Luxembourg, the supercomputer we have, Melitzina. It's one of 8 supercomputers that we have across Europe, hosted in Europe, launched in June 2021. So how is Melitzina going?
Yes, so Melitzina has recently just celebrated its first anniversary. So as you mentioned, it was launched in June last year. Actually, it goes back to an initiative that has been started by the European Commission that started in 2018. So there are several countries that they are all countries actually that are together in that network of European high performance computers, if you want. And Melitzina is one of them. And it's important to know that part of the capacity that Meluxina has, it's 35% actually used for this European part of the project, and the rest, and it is quite special for Meluxina, for the Luxembourgish HPC, it's used by the own country, and it's also used for private businesses. Most of the other HPC is actually used for mainly for research, if not only for research and for scientific use. And the Luxembourgish one was from the beginning on designed and designed also for the use of Luxembourgish, the ecosystem, and for the Luxembourgish industry, for the financial sector, but also for research, of course. So this was very special. And I think, and we can say today, that it is a success. It's been a success from the beginning on, and this for several reasons. You could even argue that only the pure fact of having it in Luxembourg has already been kind of a success, because it's kind of completing the landscape of the ICT landscape of Luxembourg. So you have different components in Luxembourg, and it kind of started with the company that I'm working for, so for LuxConnect. In 2006, there was the initiative from the government to actually create an infrastructure so that the ecosystem can use this infrastructure for their business in Luxembourg. So it was also the clear idea to make something that is makes Luxembourg more attractive, actually, for foreign investors, but also, for example, for the banking sector and for the ICT sector as such. So having this and the high-performance computer has been another step into this, and there are more steps to come. There might be, the next step might be a cloud that is specially designed for the use of the Luxembourgish ecosystem. So we are completing a history here, and HPC is a very important part of this, and it's been a success.
Yeah, it's based in Bissen, and I know a little while ago in the news we had a certain very famous company that was looking to maybe move to Bissen, so people can find that out. But actually, when I was reading about Melitzina, I love the fact that it calculates power of 10 petaflops,
yes,
which is 10 million billion operations per second. I love that word, petaflop.
I'm always wrong with the zeros behind this, but I think it's about 18 or 17 or something.
Lots of zeros, lots and lots, I think. And yeah, Melitzina's performance should be able to reach the top 50 of the world ranking of the 500 most performant supercomputers. But as you said, the aim is to develop this ecosystem and infrastructure of supercomputers on the continent of Europe. And so do you think that could help Europe, when we think about just computing power globally, it could help Europe increase its digital sovereignty?
Well, First, you mentioned that it's among the 50 top most performant computers in Luxembourg, but I'd like to add, because it's at least as important, if not more important, it's also number 15 in the world when it comes to the most green supercomputers in the world, because it's actually hosted in one of our LuxConnect data centers, and we are provided with 100% green energy. Plus, in Beeson, you also have a cogeneration plant, which means that we actually use the heat that is produced by the data center, so also by the Meluxina, to produce coal again, and also to produce wood pellets, actually. So we are exactly in that discussion that is going on right now into making data centers more and more green. And since Meluxina is one of those, it's also one of the greenest one in the world, actually. So when I see number 15.
On that point, I love that point because, in fact, I was just speaking to our previous guests about cloud computing, and I brought up the point of green energy and sustainability because we know that actually all sorts of companies will have to monitor that, and we don't always think about the cloud storage or the data centers and what their footprint is.
But I did not answer your question, so I tried to.
I know.
I used to work for politicians.
I can tell.
The thing is that, yes, we do have a problem and we have to face it about sovereignty when it comes to sovereignty, European sovereignty, when it comes to being dependent from other parts of the world. And it's a pity because if you look, for example, the market of semiconductors in the 90s, there were 40% of the world semiconductors were produced in Europe, whereas today we're talking about less than 10%. So it was there. We just gave it up. So there is a huge problem, but on the other hand, we also have to say that I would even say that the political leaders and people who have to act on this, they have realized that there is a problem. And it has, of course, been accelerated by the recent developments in the world. So there's something really shifting. On the other hand, we also have to be honest with ourselves and fair. We are living in a globalized world and we have to create partnerships. We just have to make very sure that the part that is important for us when it comes to data is in European hands. What I'm saying actually is that you could even use a technology that comes from the US or from other parts of the world, but you have to make sure that you can maintain and use this technology only as you like it. So you need the possibility to actually disconnect the technology from your use.
Trusted partnerships. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Wonderful. And I can tell that you worked for politics before. Excellent for LuxConnect that they have your voice at the helm. Femke, over to you. So Femke, just to reintroduce you, Femke Brouns, Head of Marketing, PR and Events Benelux at Polestar. And we're going to talk about connected vehicles. And I know we've got one of the vehicles right behind us here at Polestar. So when it comes to connected vehicles, we all have an idea of what that means. When do you think it will happen?
Well, I can't give you a date, but I can tell you that it's already here. Cars are already connected. They are not anymore a loose item within your the things that you own. They are completely connected now. A Polestar is driven by an Android system. So that means that within your car, you have a Google Assistant that is connected to the Google that you have on your computer and the Google that you have on your phone. So you don't even have to connect your phone anymore. It is just completely integrated in your ecosystem. If a connected car is also not something you buy and that is static, it is something that keeps evolving. So when technology improves or when new applications get introduced, you can just over the air update it, or you can download from the Play Store new applications to make your experience even better.
That sounds like some car technologies might be a little bit cheaper than they are right now.
How do you mean cheaper?
If you can just like click a button and something is just fixed in your car.
Well, that's the advantage of new cars. They need a lot less maintenance.
Well, let's hope so. But thinking about the various types of energy generation that we'll need for the future of automation over the next 30 years, there isn't going to be one solution. There will be many solutions. Can you give our audience a picture of those many solutions?
Yeah, I think from our point of view as a car manufacturer, obviously we've been part of the problem for a very, very long time. Now with electric vehicles, we are part of the solution, or we're slowly becoming part of the solution. But an electric car is only as sustainable as the energy you charge it with. So the mix of energy that you put into this electric car needs to come from sustainable sources, so renewable energy, wind energy, etc. Because otherwise, the footprint of a car that is charged with gray energy, what comes out of the regular socket, is double of what a green charged car means to us. So what the exact energy sources will be, they will have to be renewable. That's quite obvious. They have to be electric. That's also quite obvious. Where they will come from, it'll be a mix.
And then thinking about modern vehicles and the data that they generate,
sure,
there will be a huge amount of data that's coming from each vehicle as well. So how do you envisage using that data?
Well, we comply to the same rules as your computer and your iPhone does. So we don't have a right. You have to give consent for us to do it. You can opt not to do it. And then we comply to the same rules. So any restriction, any regulation on that front, we support it completely and we follow it, for sure.
And then there's a huge number of challenges. I mean, the automotive industry, along with, flights, etc., when we think about the use of fossil fuels, it's been one of those industries that's been hammered in terms of having to change. It's one
Absolutely.
Of the most obvious industries when we think about the climate and climate change.
Yes.
You've been pushed to change. What have been the greatest challenges to date, and how are you facing those challenges and moving as fast as you can as we move in together into the future?
Yeah, totally. I think the automotive industry, if you look at the past 150 years, there has been a steady growth and some technology advancements that have come. But if you look at the last 10, 15 years with computers being introduced, it's been a very steep uphill curve all of a sudden. What's even more important, I think, is that the automotive industry hasn't listened to their consumers a lot. So when we launched Polestar, we put the consumer at the center. So rather than building more glass palaces and making cars that sort of fit our production facilities, we've listened to consumers and we're really trying, and we're as I said, we're learning, we're a startup. We are building this brand listening to consumers. And then the good thing for us is that we have Geely, our owner company, with 90 years experience behind us, so they can support on all the technological side.
When you talk about designing cars for the consumer, I must say there's some great books out there about how cars were not designed actually for women, with seatbelts and various other things. So I'm not sure if you're listening to the female quotient. And I remember when my children were small, I also thought I would really redesign a car when it comes to small children.
There is plenty of technology that has been there and that has become a given. And it's been the same for many, many, many years.
Yeah.
So now with computers introducing and cars that are driven by Android as ours and cars that have electric motors, the car industry has to reinvent itself because the business model is still the same as it was 50 years ago. And that will change.
Plus the basic shape of a car. Yes, Steve.
I think that's an interesting thing to mix these three topics together, because where we're coming from at Soldo, which is payments, it's making businesses' lives easier so they can focus on their core business, which is the energy they're putting in to making a difference in the world, to making their way. And they want to spend less time with old-fashioned sort of administrative things that are painful. They're more painful than you realize when you start automating them. You think, how on earth did I do it that way before? It's incredible. It's like the difference between having a smartphone and nothing.
Yeah.
You know. And then we have ID and supercomputing and the actual energy in this way to make this happen. We have the customer centric approach. Anyone who's stepping out of a particular industry and stepping back in again, taking a customer centric approach, is already ahead of the game. And all these things combined are empowered by technology, which is then enabled and empowered by artificial intelligence. And one of the things that's happening now is a sense of automating or using AI to use more machines, more machine to machine processes. And that's a dehumanizing process. And the next wave will be rehumanizing. And the rehumanization of societies and people who are engaging in technology is where everyone will win, where they're putting their focus on making people's lives and societies more accessible and more technically empowered, because that's, again, something that we can't necessarily avoid unless we're going to have a much deeper conversation about the pros and cons of technology.
Well, I would love to have that conversation, but we might have to hold that for another time, because I think it's extremely important, that conversation. Have you any final thoughts on connected vehicles, connected cities? You've had an Thank you, Femke. You have a final word. Thank you both for your time. Femke, thank you for talking to us about Melutzina and all of it. And Steve, you must come back for more philosophical conversations. Thank you very much. Thank you.